Alright guys, we are back staring at my engine bay, and in this video we're going to be talking about how Valvetronic works in the B58 engine. This is something that BMW has been using for a very long time. They originally started using it back in 2001, and they've been using it in turbo engines since the N55, so they're not new to this, and this is something that you might be familiar with if you're coming from older platforms, but technically this is the third generation of the Valvetronic system from BMW, so I'm just going to share more detail on how this works and how it was implemented on the B58, and maybe even if you're just brand new to BMWs in general, this can hopefully give you the information you need to understand what we're talking about when we mention, you know, the Valvetronic system. So hopefully you guys find this video useful. Now, as always, for everybody that's new to the channel, I create these videos to help keep you updated on the latest developments in our community, as well as discuss technical topics so that we have a better understanding of how our engines work. So if you're interested in more videos like that, be sure to subscribe because there will be a lot more coming out in the future. So, this is basically BMW's solution to optimize our valve train. And this is kind of like the prime example that you can explain to somebody. If they say that there's a simple, you know, kind of design that works, and German engineers take that and just make it overly complicated, this is literally like Exhibit A in that court case. So the whole purpose of this is basically to optimize the efficiency of your valve train and replace your throttle body with an unlimited amount of variable valve lift control. So what do I mean by that? Well, when you look here, typically on a, you know, inline six engine, you'll have an intake cam, like what you see right here, and you'll have an exhaust cam, like what you see right there. Except if you're paying attention, you'll see there's actually a third camshaft running underneath these springs. Now that camshaft is what does a lot of the control to modify how much lift our valve sees when we're running our engine. So if we look down inside of the cylinder head, we can see all of the components. So of course, down here, you can see the actual valve spring where the valve is. Then you have your primary rocker, and that pushes down on the valve to open it up and allow air into the engine. And then up here, this is your secondary rocker. So it kind of looks like an upside down Y. And that rocker is what's actually being driven by your intake cam. So the cam pulls down on the secondary rocker, that pushes down on the primary rocker, and then that pushes down on the valve. Now the reason you have this secondary rocker is because this camshaft has a big eccentric lobe on it. And that lobe can turn, and it basically adjusts the distance from the intake cam to the primary rocker. So if it's closer, when the cam turns over, the valves will only open up a little bit. But if it extends longer and basically creates a longer arm here on that secondary rocker, it's going to push down farther and create more valve lift. So you'll be able to get more air into the cylinder for every revolution of the engine. Now, why is this important? Well, if you do this, then you have infinite control of how much air is getting into the engine. So when you're at idle, you can have low valve lift. When you floor it, you can have high valve lift. And that basically replaces the throttle body, because instead of having like that butterfly valve that you're more typically used to on other engines that controls how much air is getting into the engine, we're actually able to control it right at the cylinder head. So this is extremely efficient. You can do it based on a lot of different signals and a lot of data that's coming into the car. And it's just as variable as you would get with, you know, a throttle body. You can control exactly how much air is going into the engine by adjusting that valve lift. Now, the way that this is actually controlled is right here. So if you've got your whole engine situated and assembled, you're going to have a charge pipe in front of this. You'll have your intake manifold kind of hugging on top of this, and you'll see this little black cylinder. This is your Valvetronic motor, and it actually has a screw that's extending through this cavity. And that screw is basically engaging with this gear. So as the screw turns, it turns the gear, and that adjusts the rotation of that lobe, and that controls the length of that arm. So hopefully you guys are all following me here, but again, basically this motor turns the gear, and depending on the direction it turns, it controls how much the valves open inside the cylinder head to control how much air is getting into the engine. Now there's also a little oil squirter inside of there to make sure that all of this is lubricated. This is a completely compact system, so everything is built into it. It has a position sensor inside of it, so compared to older engines, it's a little bit more simple. It has all of the data and everything inside of here, and it also sends signals back to the DME that are constantly being checked. So if there are any issues with this motor, it should throw a fault, and it'll tell you that there's a problem with the engine. Now, this motor has a very high level of accuracy. It can actually measure in 6-degree increments as far as how it translates to this gear rotation, and that translates to about 0.25 millimeters of valve lift. So it can control to that accuracy, opening the valves every 0.25 millimeters. Now, in order to remove this motor, if you ever did need to replace it, it's pretty simple. There's a bolt on top and another bolt on bottom, and then this whole thing slides out. There's also this screw, or basically Allen key on the back, and you can use an Allen wrench to turn that, and that will allow you to manually back it off. You can also manually adjust the eccentric shaft if you're removing your cams or any of these components. You can basically turn that, and it will turn the eccentric shaft to maximum valve lift or minimum valve lift, whatever you need in order to move it into the service position. But the good news is, as I'm sure most of you realize, even if this motor does go bad and those signals indicate that you can't use the Valvetronic system, there is a backup, and that's the throttle body. So even though we have a system that replaces the throttle body, we still have a throttle body on our car, and this is actually used in a lot of different scenarios. Its primary purpose is as a backup. So if this motor does fail, the DME will basically tell it to push to the maximum valve lift and control how much power you're getting through the throttle body. So it just extends all the way and runs off of the throttle body and kind of turns that butterfly valve to control your airflow. It won't be as efficient, and it can potentially, you know, keep you in lip mode or something just to protect the engine, but at least the car will be drivable. They also use it to help create some vacuum in the car. So like if you're at idle, the throttle valve will close as much as possible so that the intake manifold is actually pulling a vacuum, and that gives you something to pull on your PCV gases, your EVAP fumes, you know, everything that you would need to have like a vacuum source, you can pull from your intake manifold because the throttle body is closing at idle. It's also used for boost control, as you guys have probably experienced. When you have a throttle closure, the throttle is kind of like a backup control to limit how much boost is getting into the engine. And you can tell the differential when you read, you know, your pressure sensor in your charge pipe versus the pressure sensor in the manifold. You can see the delta when that throttle valve closes because, you know, you're going over your boost targets. So it does like a lot of fancy things in the background, but your primary control for acceleration and just creating power is through the Valvetronic system. Now, the last thing I want to mention is that there is an adaptation sequence for this. So basically, when you start the car, if there are any indications that it can't tell the signal, it will run it through its entire length. So it'll go all the way out and all the way back in to find the limits of the Valvetronic motor. That is one of the sounds that you hear sometimes when you turn on your car. It's like a really loud buzzing sound. And when you unlock your doors, like if you put your finger on here, you can actually feel it running. So I know a lot of noises are made when you first turn on the car, and that'll give you an idea of what that sounds like. Like I said, just put your finger on here while somebody opens the door, and you'll be able to tell that, you know, this is where that noise is coming from. And yeah, I think that pretty much sums it up. You know, again, this is a really genius system that helps our cars operate as efficiently as possible. It's pretty much as close as you can get to like having ITBs, where each individual cylinder has its own throttle body. This takes it a step closer and actually controls the valve itself. So it's a really genius operation, but of course a lot of moving pieces compared to, you know, a typical engine. And luckily, now in the B58, it's extremely robust and extremely reliable, but still something that you want to pay attention to and at least understand if you were to see a code that indicated Valvetronic motor issue or eccentric shaft position failure. a lot of that is tied back to this Valvetronic motor and the Valvetronic system. So now hopefully you have a better idea of how things work. And if you do see an issue, you have an idea of what you should look at first. So yeah, that's it for this video. Thank you guys for watching, and I hope this helps. And if you have any other questions or comments, leave them down below. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do